Thank you. हेलो।
हेलो
हेलो हेलो,
हेलो
हु इज टॉकिंग?
हेलो, गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून।
वीडियो गुड आफ्टरनून।
या हेलो,
गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून,
वेरी वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून।
वेरी
एग्जाम
thank you.
Very good afternoon to all of you. First of all, let me welcome all the participants who are taking part in this webinar and the invited faculty who are going to deliver the lectures for this particular webinar titled as Evaluation in Higher Medical Education. At the outset, let me also thank the organizers for asking me to moderate this particular session. And to start with, what is education? I mean, if you go back and look at the definition of education, it will be something. But to quote Albert Einstein, what he said about education is that education is what you remember after forgetting what is taught in the school. So that is how he defined it, and it is widely quoted by many. My quotation, which is anonymous, goes like this. For postgraduate education, what you have learned is what you remember after forgetting what has been taught. So finally, what you remember after leaving the college is only the culture of learning. If the person has got the culture of learning imbibed into him when he is doing the course, I'm happy, and I'm happy that he'll be successful in his life. That is how I take education as. And when we come to evaluation, what we mean by evaluation? Because this is evaluation in higher medical education. There are two terminologies that get interposed when we talk about evaluation. One is assessment, and other one is evaluation. Both of them are interchangeably used. I would just like to give a little brief on this to say that both require criteria, both require evidence, and then measurement scales. But how is assessment different from evaluation? Assessment is an ongoing process. It improves learning, it is ungraded, it provides feedback, and it is process-oriented. Whereas if you look at the evaluation is terminal, and it is judgmental. And it says either pass or fail, it is graded, either pass or fail. And it tries to bring out the shortfalls in a person, and it is product oriented. These are the two different things altogether. And quite often these two are mixed together and confused by many people. Now, if we say that our topic is on evaluation in higher medical education, and we know that evaluation has not changed for the past about 50 years. When I did my post-graduation, how I was evaluated terminally, remains almost the same even now after 45 years. So there's quite a bit of concern in everybody's mind. What are we doing? Are we doing the right thing? Do we have to change? To bring about the concerns in this particular aspect, concerns in evaluation system in higher medical education, we have with us Dr. Professor Raveja, who is the Honorary Vice Chancellor of Sri Balaji Vidyapeetham, eminent academician, erudite microbiologist, researcher, keen votary of medical education, and able administrator. He was the former director of JIPMA. He had authored more than 16 books, including most recent, Effective Medical Communication, and authored more than 400 plus papers in national and international journals. He was appointed as member, expert member on the Food and Agriculture Organization of WHO for advice on foodborne parasitic diseases. He has also been conferred with the B.C. Roy Award, a national award, in the year 2003 for his nodal contributions to the development of medical microbiology. He was the founder of the Indian Academy of Tropical Parasitology, and he has been conferred with various fellowships, including FAMS, FICAI, FABM, and FIMASA, etc. It's my pleasure to invite Dr. S.C. Parija to deliberate on this particular topic on concerns in evaluation systems in higher medical education. What about you, sir?
Good afternoon, dear Professor Ravi Shankar, Director E-Learning of our university, Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth, and my dear other speakers for this webinar on evaluation in higher medical education. Professor K.R. Sethuraman, Professor Arun Jamkar, and all participants. At the outset, on my behalf and behalf of our Balaji Vidyapeeth, I extend a hearty welcome to all of you to this interesting seminar, webinar on evaluation in higher medical educations. As sorry, just I'm trying to share my screen. I will share some of my thoughts and concerns in evaluation system of higher medical education. I'll take this 15 to 20 minutes to share my thoughts on three most important aspects. First and foremost being, I'll present in brief about the role of assessment in our education and what we understand by the term assessment in higher education. And next, I discuss about various challenges in developing an effective evaluation in higher education. And I summarize with the key challenges of assessment for outcome-based educations. Before that, we must understand this higher education scenario in the 21st century in contrast to the last 20th century. In this century, education is evolving, and the most important concept that it has started valuing outcomes and the process of learning rather than the content of learning. When we are students in the 20th century pursuing MBBS or postgraduate programs, that time it was mostly we are evaluated our education was focused rather more on the content of learning. Now, there is a paradigm shift from that to the content of learning. And another important content we must understand, that curriculum design is now shifted from teacher-centering processes or activities that was earlier. Now it is more rather student or process-centric approaches. And more value is being added for the evidence of skill profile rather than the grades. and definitely the most important components that is being tried to be integrated with the learning process is the value of soft skills, value of communication, value of professionalism, value of ethics. All those things which as a medical student was expected to learn but was never given any importance in the learning process. And where we think the changes of higher education in this 21st century, we cannot forget the important role of digital area in this 21st century. We must understand that any outcome process, any learning process or assessment process in education, including higher educations, will be affected by the digital era, and that needs to be taken into consideration when we are recommending any assessment process. As Professor Ravi Shankar has evaluated, defined the term evaluations, one of term that can be defined is the process of examining a program or process to determine what is working and what is not and why. In a sense, evaluation determines the value of learning and training programs and acts as blueprints for judgment and improvement. It determines the merit or significance of something or someone using criteria against a set of standard identified or a set of standard prescribed. Now currently, before we go discuss our assessment in the century, let's try to understand currently the evaluation system we are following in medical educations, whether undergraduate medical education or postgraduate medical educations. It can be broadly categorized into two types, formative assessment and summative assessment. As you all of us know, formative assessment is ongoing evaluations conducted during at the end of a unit, and that tries to capture strength and weakness of a learner and definitely provides a system to give feedback for the facilitators of the instructions. Whereas summative assessment, it is decisive in nature. It is conducted at the completion of academic term with the first MBBS or second MBBS, third MBBS, so on. And this summative assessment is recorded as a permanent record of performance of a student, either student pass or student fails. Now, there are many concerns in the evaluation system, both at undergraduate and postgraduate. As we know, the current evaluation system in MBBS relies more on assessment of theoretical knowledge. And definitely the absence of a competency-based curriculum and evaluation system. And while we do formal assessment, this is mostly carried out to test memorization skills rather than other skills. And summative assessment in the form of university examinations are the mainstay of evaluation systems than the formative assessment. Because formative assessments are poorly designed, often fail to provide scope for remedial measures, and are also irregular. There is a great degree of bias of examiner in theory paper evaluations, and that is a major concern. It has been expressed on different occasions, and all students and our faculty, they also experience it. In postgraduate evaluation, postgraduate educations, mostly the summative assessment in the form of university examinations have a greater weightage than the formative assessment, and less emphasis is on the development of the cognitive skills, professional competencies, and learning outcome. More or like undergraduate courses, it is on the content based. There is less emphasis on research related outcome, even though a student spends more than 2.5 years for compiling a thesis or dissertations as part of the degree requirement. And it is felt that there is a lack of benchmarking in theory paper evaluations. That also affects the validity of theory evaluations. So in this context, what is the role of assessment? Why assessments are needed? We must understand the important concept that assessment drives learning. By this, what I mean, assessment are what influence the way a student spends his time. This influences what skills he values and focuses his attention towards. If assessment is mostly for memory based assessment, then obviously a student has spent most of the time in memorizing the content. Or if the skills shift, or the assessment skill shifts to the skill-based evaluation, obviously the student will spend most of time to improve his or skills in various skills. Hence, the best way to influence learning is by changing the way we view assessments. Assessment have many roles, but three important roles are that it optimizes the capabilities of all the learners. This is a formative assessment. And obviously, by assessment, it discriminates between incompetent and competent physicians by recommending competent physicians, and whereas by failing the incompetent physicians. That's summative assessment. And this assessment provides a basis definitely for choosing the learners for the advanced training. It's a competitive role. So in essence, it has three roles: formative, summative, and competitive. But the main problem for the educationist is to difficulty to select an optimal assessment tool, keeping in mind the sustainability and cost effectiveness. So now when we are thinking of assessment, what should be assessed? All of us agree that competence is the key word that needs to assess. Considering medical education, we have the challenges to design assessment, keeping in mind several core competencies. Core competencies of medical knowledge, of technical skill, clinical reasoning, professionalism, communication skills, and reflexes. There are different core competencies. An ideal assessment tool is be successful if it tries to evaluate all these competencies. But all of us know currently, definitely we have been more or less successful in assessing medical knowledge and skill. But other components like professionalism, communication, critical thinking, reflexes are hardly evaluated or hardly assessed, because we don't have a tool to assess those skills. Hence, in order to select an assessment, that is most effective we have to consider is validity, means how it is able to test, what it is mean to test, reliabilities, that is the ability to give stable and consistent results among hundreds of students being screened or assessed in a particular time, and what is impact, educational impact, how it promotes or to enhance the learning, and objectivity and feasibilities. Because it is known that students of this century are definitely more likely to challenge the grades. It makes it very essential that the assessment methods chosen can stand the legal scrutiny for reliability and validity. And that is what sometimes it happens. For a summative assessment, validity, reliability, and objectivity are the most important principles. Whereas for formative assessment, we have to consider educational impact. So now we must also define, identify who should assess. Traditionally, the control of assessment has been with the teachers. They have been assigned not only the role of teaching, but definitely also assess. But in this 21st century, definitely there's a shift, rethinking towards the multi-source assessment. That also now takes into value of the peer assessments, value of self-assessment, reflections, in addition to the assessment role of the teachers. Hence, these assessments have been proven to be more insightful and trustworthy. So the biggest concern in the current competency-based medical education document is the potential mismatch between the teaching methods and assessment methods. It speaks well in detail about the teaching methods, but there's a lacking of matching between teaching and assessment methods. There's a lot of clarity in what is it to assess. It is well defined, but there's a challenge put forth to us how to do this, when to do it, and who should do this assessment. Assessment of soft skills, where the conventional assessment do not prove it effective, is another challenge. Traditional assessment seems to work well in the early years of MBBS, where we assess most in knowledge. But these methods are inefficient when it comes to later years, pre-final and final MBBS. Another concern is the shift from testing memory to test higher level of cognition like integration, critical, etc. And that is large number of students in a batch, even 150, 200 or 250 students becomes a major challenge to handle. And to match number of students, we have also shortage of trained faculties. Furthermore, lack of availability of patients as learning and assessment in medicine is opportunistic. So, assessment have to be conducted in the correct setting and at the appropriate stage of learning. Self and peer assessment need to be integrated into the curriculum, which is being now largely ignored. All stakeholders need to be trained to handle assessments. And blueprints of the assessment must be extensive to include all the competencies, core competencies, that including the soft skills to be tested and certified. And obviously, multiple methods and multiple assessment will be the key instead of a single method and single assessment. To finally, I like to serve with this conclude that the process of assessment adopted in higher education should foster future learning. It should promote future learning. Assessment need to motivate and inspire learning, not to be punitive. Readdressing the assessment method, obviously, hence, is the key component of transforming medical education in this century. All forms of assessment have definitely inherent benefit, but definitely it has also inherent flaws. Hence, appropriate selections need to be made, keeping in mind the purpose. Self and peer assessment have to be valued, given importance, and incorporated in summative assessment. I just conclude taking the quote from Wood in 1998. He mentioned, students can, with difficulty, escape from the effect of poor teaching. However, they cannot, even if they want to graduate, escapes the effect of poor assessment. Hence, assessment is the key in all type of education, particularly much more in higher medical education. Thank you. Thank you very much for your patience hearing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Parija. It is well said that assessment drives learning. That's what you emphasized on. And we are not assessing the critical thinking and reflections that needs to take place in the student. And also you said that correct setting and appropriate method needs to be used for proper assessment. So these things are quite valid. And I think we'll take these points forward with the next speaker. In the meantime, I would like to say the participants can put the questions in the chat box and we'll address these questions at the end of the session. Thank you. So to address these questions, definitely the assessment, improved assessment has a huge effect on the quality of learning. That is, everybody accepts that. And a well-designed formative assessment can focus the patients on effective learning. So these are the two key points. And with this, we move on to the next speaker, that is Professor K.R. Sethuraman. He is presently working as the Dean of Faculty of Medicine, AIIMS University, Malaysia. To give a brief introduction to him, he acquired his MBBS and MD from JIPMER Pondicherry, and he has more than 36 years of post-MD experience in the academic field. He had worked in the Department of Medicine at JIPMER from 1981 to 2006 at various capacities and retired as Director Professor of Internal Medicine. During this period, he was coordinator of the National Teachers Training Center and he headed the Department of Medical Education in JIPMER. And in the NTTC, he has trained over 1,000 medical educationists who are all heading the medical education units in various parts of the medical colleges now. Being a well-known medical educationist, he served as a dean and senior professor of the Faculty of Medicine and deputy vice chancellor, academic and international affairs of the AIIMS University, Malaysia for 7 years, from 2006 to 2013. He took over as the Vice Chancellor of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth in 2013, and he was here for 5 years till 2018. where he has taken the Balaji Vidyapeeth to a greater heights in NAAC and any other ranking in academics. During his tenure, he conducted faculty development for all medical faculty, preparing them to see how to prepare the OSCE for examinations. And he introduced OSCE in the exams, and he also conducted a focus group meeting to bring out a concept book on OSCE by organizing an All India level group meeting. And that was submitted to the Medical Council of India in 2014 for further taking it forward. I can't find any person, other better person than him to talk about objective structured clinical examination as a tool of assessment as learning in higher medical education. And with this small introduction, I hand it over to you, Dr. Professor Sethuraman.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi. No formalities between us. I know him much longer than I know my wife, since 1966. We are classmates and close friends for many decades now. So thank you very much for inviting me once more. And I start with my recording my thanks to our Chancellor, Honorable Rajagopalan sir, and the present VC Prof. Parija, and all the new friends and old friends from both places. I think about half the people, or at least one fourth of the people, must be from AIIMS watching it now. The other half must be from Balaji Vidyapeeth. So plus from rest of India and maybe some other places. So thank you very much for logging in. My talk will be very short, and it will be only about 12 to 13 minutes, I think. So let us see how it goes. I hope you can see the screen.
Yes, sir.
Is it visible?
We can. Yeah, we can. Yeah.
Okay. So basically, I want to share two epiphany with you, which is 30 years apart. And ironically, both have an underlying principle that is one and the same. So I'll just share the stories with you. That is basically the thing. And no high funda theories now, because the thing is to act to help our students. So theory can take care of itself. So what was epiphany? Epiphany means eureka moment, or what Archimedes felt when he suddenly realized the solution to the problem, cried eureka and ran out of the bathtub. So that kind of realization was there during December 1987, final year MBBS exam in JIPMA, where one student came running to me with shaking hands, sweating all over the place, and saying, "Sir, the BP is not recordable. Even at 300, I can hear Korotkov sound and all that." So you know that we never gave hypertensives as short case or long case to the exam. I said, "Not possible, man." And then anyway, I went to the bedside to see. And then what happened is, this is what happened. He had kept the mercury column horizontal instead of vertical. And no wonder BP was 300. If the mercury column was 1,000 mm long, then it would have recorded 1,000 mm also. So, and when I pointed it out, he didn't recognize. He still was looking perplexed.
But
that is the time I had enlightenment, like Buddha, saying, "Oh, we have trained this guy in a so-called National Institute of Importance and all that for 5 years. And he has managed to ignore and be ignored during all the clinical postings, and even during physiology posting, where there is a full practical of blood pressure measurement. And then this has been caught too late in the final year exam. Fortunately, I was only a skilled assistant. I was not the examiner with a pass-fail duty, you know, which is ethically problematic. So since I was skilled assistant, I quickly adjusted the BPA apparatus and told him. But the thing is, I took home the message that here are people super selected. That time it was only 65 students out of some 20,000 to 30,000 who take entrance exam at that time. And then the chosen ones, some of them end up like this, that with all theory knowledge but no skills. So what to do about that? So that was the thing. Later, 10 years later, in fact, 12 years later, Dunning and Kruger wrote a paper on this. So I wish somebody in NTTC had written a paper on this, but we never did. And that's about why incompetent people think they are awesome. So yeah, they say incompetent students are in the stage of unconscious incompetence, and they fail to recognize and acknowledge their own lack of skill, fail to recognize genuine skill in others. And after they get exposed to training for that skill, they may actually move from unconscious incompetence to conscious incompetence. So the boy in focus went into the stage, not in second year, not in third year, but only in the final year clinical examination. So I hope at least during internship, he was taking blood pressure correctly. So the Dunning-Kruger effect was in evident, and without knowing the principle, I took it as a personal mission that every student must perform, must do skills. Every PG would observe each each student performing, and then give corrective feedback to eliminate any learning error. And this was innovative use of remedial education rather than examination or evaluation. So purely formative, there is no pass fail, only to help them. In fact, it met with resistance. First of all, some pundits in NTTC laughed at it and said, "What is this man? OSCE is an evaluation tool. You are saying it is a remedial education. It's not a teaching tool. Don't talk nonsense," you know, that kind of thing, a dismissive attitude. Some others, my HOD was very unhappy with all this. What is this new kind of funny teaching and all that? So he dismissed all the PGs whom I had trained, and then put a new set. I was about to give up. Then what made me go on is, the students came to my house that evening. I was in the campus saying, "Sir, please don't stop, please continue." So it was very evident that it was very useful, otherwise they wouldn't have come home and asked. So then I trained the new PGs, and then it went on and on. So then I heard that it's still going on after 30 years. Even now, the current HOD, Dr. Abdul Hamid, says it is still being done on during final year. And this is assessment as learning. And nowadays, instead of calling it formative assessment, summative assessment, and all that, this is the trend now. Assessment for learning or pretest. So diagnostic one, identify the level of knowledge or lack of knowledge, lack of skills prior to instruction. If this had been done in third year, we would have picked up this by keeping the mercury column horizontal. So we didn't do assessment for learning. At least in final year, I could do before the exams assessment as learning, where it is formative, provides feedback aimed at understanding what is expected and improving one's performance. And self-assessment, peer assessment is key component. I used my postgraduates for supervisory assessment. And finally, assessment of learning is a summative evaluation, which is what moderator Prof. Ravi said in the beginning, pass-fail judgment has to be made. Okay. So what happened when we actually did that? So I'll just share two score sheets with you. So the postgraduates were given a checklist with a grid sheet where all the students were marked in column, and all the steps were in horizontal rows. Then you get a score sheet somewhat like this. This is a group of 10 students who are posted in medicine. And you see the score. I didn't put all plus and minus because it's confusing. For each step, you see the group total in the final column. Step 1, step 2, step 4, and step 6, almost all except one or two did. But step 3 and step 5, only a minority did. So this actually was examination of clubbing. I went and looked at the case. It was a gross clubbing, but they missed step 3, that is comparing both hands. And they missed step 5, that is comparing hand and feet, toes, fingers and toes for clubbing. So this was missed by majority. So it is a learning error of the whole group. So when the feedback was given, we teach them, why is it important to examine both hands, differential clubbing? Why is it important to examine feet? So So what are the conditions where feet get clubbed before hand and vice versa? So these are taught. So after that, they correct these mistakes. As a group, they correct and majority do it correctly. So this I labeled as type A procedural error, type A error or type A procedural error, which is relatively easy to correct. This is grid sheet 2. Here you can see that all the steps were done almost by a majority of the people, only one or two missed. But the perception or interpretation of the sign, only 4 out of 10 got it right. Actually, this was a case of plantar reflex, where it's not even like a murmur or a lung sound. After all, plantar is either extends or goes up or goes down. But like tossing a coin. So even by toss of coin, 5 should have got it right, but 6 got it wrong. So it means that this group has no concept of what is plantar extensor, what is plantar flexor. Theory they know, but when the patient moves the toes, how to interpret that? No, that is a different skill. That is a perceptive skill. Any amount of theory reading doesn't help. So we have to show them many cases until they get the perceptual concept. This is much more difficult to correct. So corrective strategies were planned. Once we had this insight, this was epiphany spin-off from the first one. Okay, group errors is a good feedback for the teachers. The procedural errors due to inadequate stress during bedside teaching. Because we get disturbed by so many things. So not everything can be told during bedside teaching. So during this OSCE, we can pick it up by the whole group missing it or majority of the group missing that step. And we can give an effective clinical demo, remedial during post-OSCE debriefing or feedback. So that corrects this quite easily. But on the other hand, perceptual error due to a poor perceptual concept like inability to distinguish murmur systole from diastole or vesicular breath sound from bronchial breath sound and all that, or abdominal auscultation. So these are fetal heart sound is a very great example in obstetrics gynae. Every specialty has its own. Inability to discriminate between normal versus abnormal. So this learning by concept attainment model, it is available. You can download and read those articles, how to teach for procedural concept attainment. So basically it means giving many examples, positive examples and negative examples. So it is difficult to arrange, but we used to arrange case mela for cardiac murmur in the cardiac clinic. Dr. Balachandar will allow, we used to go and arrange a case mela of all the systolic murmurs. So they get a concept, all the diastolic murmurs another day. In neurology clinic, plantar, elicit plantar of all the 50 patients there. No, nothing else, they only elicit plantar and knee reflex or something, just to get a few concepts which are difficult to gauge for the particular batch. So that helped, but it is difficult to arrange. And this is the result of this two batches we did in that time, 1988-89. Initially, I was very meticulously documenting all this. So type A error, 11 out of 20 students. And after correction, it was 0. Perceptual error, 7. And after a little bit of explanation, a few cases, demo, 5 were corrected, there are still 2 persisting. And combined error, where 1 and 2 both were perceptual error is more difficult. Sometimes they have to become postgraduates before they can actually hear a fetal heart sound with confidence. Okay, now epiphany 2 is at MGMCRI. When I was teaching and also supervising what is going on, Dr. Ravi was the dean then. Mahalakshmi arranged this formative OSCE for year 3. MBBS conducted after clinical orientation for a few weeks. Then the feedback given by faculty supervisors who manned all the OSCE stations was very revealing and also disturbing to me. Because most of them had said the students don't know anything background, they're just doing something like monkeys recording, they can't interpret, they can't understand anything and all that. Then I realized that these lecturers and assistant professors and residents expect first clinical year people just after 6 weeks of orientation to perform like final year students. This was second epiphany that happened 30 years later. But the irony is, this is the other side of Dunning-Kruger effect. Dunning-Kruger effect also says, just like student is ignorant about the skill, lack of skill, the fault of the teachers is they assume that students know it already and they don't teach. Like BP, nobody teaches. Everybody knows, even a monkey can take BP, man. So why should I teach? You know, that kind of thing. So teachers also ignore the student's plight and assume that have illusion that all the students can learn by themselves. So this was second epiphany that happened. Then I dug up my vast collection of educational articles and found out that the answer was in what is called as rhyme framework. So I tried to introduce the concept in Mahatma Gandhi Medical in 2017 and Satya Sai also. I don't know if it is still going on. But here, after coming here as Dean in Medicine, past 3 years, we are doing this RIME program. The RIME, R-I-M-E, basically means it's a graded clinical assessment concept and graded clinical training also, training and assessment. In the year two, physiology days, and year three, first clinical year, they learn only to report, record history and read it out, record physical findings and read it out. They need not know interpretation. If they know it is good, above average, but not expected. In year four, after they finish pathology and have more additional training, they learn to interpret what does the recorded history mean, what does the recorded physical signs mean. M is management. So they learn in year five how to manage the cases, outline of management at undergraduate level. And later during internship, educator, that is two types of education. One is educating oneself, constant upgrading of skills and knowledge, and educating the patients and patient relative on the nature of illness, what is the prognosis, how to treat, what is the follow-up, etc. Instead of just writing TCA 1 month, no, to come after 1 month. That is okay, but it has to be associated with or attached with effective education. So that is learned during internship. So this is what we are attempting. Our RIME framework, the students have reached final year just now. So if you, maybe 2 years later, I'll share the experience, how effective it has been to make well-rounded medical students that come out of our medical school at Ames University. So with that, I want to sum up and wrap up. Formative OSCE is very useful tool as assessment, as learning, and to pinpoint errors and correct learning errors, both individual error and group error, before the final year exams. Group performance reflects effectiveness of clinical instruction. It is a feedback to the teachers, you and me. Group errors can be type A, procedural mistakes, or type B, perceptual, conceptual errors, or combined, where both may be weak. Procedural errors are more easily correctable by explanation and demonstration. Perceptual errors need repeated practice, especially case malas, where several cases of similar type is shown to them. And by making PG supervised undergraduate performance, they benefit by reviewing their own clinical skills. And finally, we need to adopt a RIME framework to custom design OSCE checklist to align with the learner progress from year two to year five. So thank you very much. Whenever times become normal, please visit our university, very friendly campus. You can stay here with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sethuraman. Would you like to take questions now straight away? Because there are two questions which have come.
You are the moderator. Whatever you say,
is okay. Because I thought it'll be more context-wise, so I'll just give you that question. There is still so much of resistance from the people concerned to make OSCE as part of summative assessment. Your views on this? That is question number one.
Okay.
And
okay, question number one, I'll take that depends on the country. Now a national medical commission has come. Hopefully they'll be more open-minded and more receptive to new ideas. And in Malaysia, for example, OSCE is a major component. Our year four clinical exams in medicine, surgery, OG pediatrics, and community medicine is totally OSCE based. And even ENT ophthal is embedded, medicine and allied specialties, surgery and allied specialties, including ENT ophthal, all OSCE based pass-fail decisions. And year five, there is integrated exam where clinical component of short case, long case is there. That with a separate pass-fail, but for grading purposes, we add OSCE also with the equal weightage. So 50% clinical case component with separate pass-fail, and OSCE is a separate component at the pass-fail mechanism. So okay. Many countries in US, for example, court in 1987, I think, ruled out long case as a method of examination in the final exam, because a high gold medalist failed in final year and he challenged the court. It's unreliable tool. So that nationally it has been banned, and they have adopted OSCE and that mini clinical encounter, mini CEX exam being done in USA since then.
I think the question pertains to India because the context is India, and so possibly it is possibly what you are saying is correct setting and appropriate method has to be used. So the mindset is still not changed in India.
Shall well, the I thing is, they have to see what is happening in the rest of the globe. Now it is a World Medical Federation has put up medical education, desirable traits, what to reach and all that. So this has to be disseminated. If educators join up together, they can do. If engineers can do it. They have done it 30 years back. Why we cannot do it and increase our internal assessment and
see. Okay, the second question, shall I go?
Yeah, please, yes. Please.
OSCE is mainly must-know area. Can it be used for nice-to-know areas?
Yeah, definitely. We have one or two stations out. Now, usually a skill will be followed with some questions. In that one, say part B or part C will be for a high funda question, so that we get a nice bell curve. I wish I had prepared it. If anyone wants, I can share the bell curve of our OSCE results.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sethu. I mean, the few questions which we'll take at the end, we'll move on to the next section of that. This particular webinar, and this section is about advances in evaluation of higher medical education. For this particular talk, I would like to invite Professor Arun Jamkar. He is the former Vice Chancellor of Maharashtra University Health Sciences, Nasik. And he's also chair of National Bioethics Curriculum Implementation, UNESCO. To give a short introduction to him, he did his undergraduate from Government Medical College, Aurangabad. Since then, he has spent 3 decades teaching surgery and performing thousands of operations as general surgeon, laparoscopic surgeon, urologist, transplant surgeon, etc., in places like Grand Medical College, Mumbai, and his consistent inclination towards medical research resulted in a PhD in surgical oncology from National Institute of Virology. He is the vice chancellor of, he was the former vice chancellor of Maharashtra University of Health Sciences, Nasik. His talent in academic reforms made him a member of the expert group of the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India, for recommending amendments in the existing Medical Council of India Act. He had taken a lot of initiative and helped to create an ecosystem for interdisciplinary research between science, technology, Ayurvedic, and homeopathic medicine, And one such example of interdisciplinary collaboration was clinical engineering by creating engineers for the hospital. He had been a pioneer in collaborating computers and medical informatics in medicine. I am told presently he is working on a project called Second Opinion, creating an artificial intelligence system using a machine learning to advise patients and doctors about interventions that are needed. And he is also a medical educationist par excellence. And during his tenure as vice chancellor, he had introduced various reforms in education, communication skills, values in medical education, and one such strength was evaluation system for students. I have great pleasure inviting Dr. Arun Jamkar to give his opinions on this particular title, that is Advances in Evaluation for Higher Medical Education. Over to you, Dr. Jamkar.
Thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I will share my screen. Can you see my screen?
We can see.
Thank you. So let me first thank Dr. Parija and Mr. Rajagopalan for inviting me for a wonderful webinar, which has been organized by Dr. Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth. I think they are one of the most progressive universities in the country. And my job has been made very easy by earlier speakers. They talk nicely about the higher education and the evaluation. I'm going to talk on advances, and basically I'm going to talk more about how technology can help and how the various platforms are available and how AI systems can be used. So thanks for my introduction. At present, actually, I am a distinguished professor with Symbiosis International University. In addition, I work as a director of PG programs in the MIML Medical College. And my passion for technology is there. So I'm a consultant in persistent systems as a healthcare consultant. Now, my job has been made easy. Everybody knows about the Miller's pyramid and the scope of all of these evaluation methods. And then we start from knows how, shows how. And then various scopes of various methodologies are there. And then Dr. Sethuraman had been talking about OSCE. I have to pay him, tribute for his contribution for faculty development before MCI came into picture. I think you are commendable. And Dr. Parija's work is also commendable. So let us put that now mini CX and all that they come under. And then we have a series of pattern about how all these from knows how, shows how, and does. And these various components of evaluation come from, the first two steps become cognition, and then other step becomes a behavior, and how to put them together. And then we marry the Miller's pyramid with the Bloom's taxonomy, where it has go into, six layers. So remember, understand, apply, analyze, evaluate, and create. And therefore, I think everybody understands about this. And therefore, we need to understand from how it is going up from, remembering to creation. We are creating would mean a combining a part to make a new whole. And now the Bloom's revised taxonomy has been modified to include all of them. Now, this is all basics. Therefore, I'm not going to talk much. But then what is important now is how I'm just trying to tell you and put across how the remaining science education, especially technology education, is putting these facts. And therefore, there are a lot of things to maybe extrapolate. So this is an Iowa State University, and where we have same thing about the cognitive down process dimension, where it goes from remember, understand, apply, analyze, and same thing. Whereas on this side, the domains have been little modified, that the factual, conceptual, procedural, there is one more dimension there. And these are all categories for what's called as a program outcome. That knowledge, everybody knows, but then we have to understand and basic nature. Then skills, where all the psychomotor skills, where they are modifying. And then attitude, and it was very, say, heartening to see that even there's attitude, we are talking education. And therefore, teachers going down from factual knowledge, conceptual knowledge, procedural knowledge, and metacognitive knowledge. So here, what they are doing is the factual knowledge has been converted and it has been given as a factual and a conceptual knowledge. And the cognitive process is same. So I think I'm not going to much detail, but then this marriage of both the cognitive process dimension goes up, that apply, they respond to frequently asked questions, then provide advice to the know-hows, and then analyze, they go to differentiate in higher and lower culture, and then integrate, and then judge efficiency. And I think this is a nice pyramid, which I think we need to understand, because our medical education and we may adapt the factual and conceptual knowledge, because procedural is psychomotor skills, whereas metacognitive is again attitude. But whereas we can take this, the factual knowledge and conceptual knowledge, the conceptual knowledge as a process where we require creative thinking, I think that might be added. So at present, there is so much of explosion of knowledge, and medical education has gone so high that we require an augmented intelligence, or what you call as AI or AW. And now I'm not going to much detail, but then it's an AI, artificial intelligence, which defined as a machine with intelligent behavior, such as perception, reasoning, and learning. But then artificial wisdom is beyond, because the thing which say AI cannot do, has to understand, because medical education, especially evaluation, require what is called as a wisdom. Now, while we take examination and summative examination, we just don't go by how many questions are being answered. What we say, are bhai bachche ko aata hai. And therefore, this is what is called as wisdom, where now this is another explosion taking place in technical knowledge from data, information, knowledge, and wisdom. And therefore, I think what is required is utilizing all these technologies, creating new wisdom, because at the end, evaluation is a wisdom for the teacher. And therefore, what I'm going to do is how all these AI systems were being used everywhere in various aspects of medical education. So I'm not going to go in much detail, but I think some of things can be given. And then suppose you do say survey of the articles of AI systems in medical education, there are hardly any which is going to evaluation, because the assessment and object assessment are only 4, 3, 5. And therefore the publications are coming, but I think we need to find out that how all these AI systems could be used to create a better ecosystem for evaluation. So if you see the conclusion, that what we must see that we need to have a better integration of AI into medical profession, and this has to be done. So the student response was there, and one of the students who nicely said that the AI should be used more in assessment, and that is far better. So with this, I'm going to say how the systems can be used. Now, the major problems of evaluation today is we all have a summative exam, and we all have a single paper which is given across the country, let us say NEET. Or then what happens is it is technically impossible to supervise and regulate. So now with this background and with this platform, I'm just trying to introduce a new idea that why not create a question paper based on difficulty index and differentiation index, so that the same paper did not be used everywhere, because this question paper would be on graded, progressively difficult questions, and then we can have routine procedures. And as a net result, once we use a technology creating a question bank which is classified depending on a difficulty index and a differentiation index, then a computer generated program can give you exact same quality question paper across. And every center can have a new set of question paper. I think this is far more important, because then whole problem of say online exam will go on. Because at this moment, online exams, although with the COVID time, are in need of our, but then nobody's trying to do. Because I think this is the one which I want to suggest to all of the education, is that we need to have a whole system which is what is called as a classifying a question bank which is progressive, and then you could say have a GRE type pattern. Suppose a student answers 80% of question, all the questions are asked, and then all those questions which are answered are taken for 80%. So I think this gradation has to be done. And you might be worried about how it could be done. Then we have a rubric of assessment, and then calculation of difficulty index and difficulty index can be taken by a platform where the questions can be mapped. Then they can find out what are the topics, and these rubrics can go into mapping of level of competencies and maybe going up. And then we can go up the Miller's pyramid, finding out questions, coverages, competency levels. And then as a net result, the topic-wise assessment, subject-wide assessment, the whole question paper can be created. And then once it is created, you could have a whole profile about what are the competencies being done. And this whole thing could be done. And therefore, this could be put into a question paper management system where we have a database of a question bank, and then a computer generates. Now this you can take it down, but then that whole thing, once you have a platform, then it starts from a dean's login, then he declares, you can select the exam date, then can create an exam template. Hello, am I audible? And then status, and then once you have that, then mapping could be done to be question papers, and then question bank statistics, the teachers login. You can have additional of question depending on say same data, and then setting of a question parameters, and then the question paper can be moderated. This all concerning a platform. Once we decide, then I think whole thing can be approved through a technology, and then question paper can be printed. I think this is what is required. Is once you have a question bank, say which is classified, that whole and then you can have a competency-based scenarios. Now these are all available with USMLE. So because at the end, we are tend to ask all these questions depending upon only recall. There is nothing like creative. So competency-based education requires to have a clinical judgment. These are 4 or 5 questions of say domain like professionalism, then pharmacotherapy, and this whole thing is available. And I think this we need to follow now. And suppose I am not going to give this link, but then say my recording will be available, and then you can go to the link, and then the USMLE, the primum pattern and whole pattern is there where we have a scenario scene, and then the student answer, then additional information is given. You can give all the investigations, then it goes to management. I think this whole profile of clinical reasoning comes. I think this whole thing has to come into a assessment. Now, Dr. Parija has been talking about how to validate and how to do reliability. So what happens, I'm going to put one more important thing, is what is called as a dynamic real-time assessment of student. This nobody has done. I think a university like Balaji with their bit where they are very progressive, they can do. Now, let us say we know about reliability, that all the modes of management, reliability goes and differentiates. Say, let us say MCQ is 0.62% and mini-6 is 0.73%. OSCE is 0.47. And this is whole thing because the testing time is 1 hour. Testing time is 1 hour. And the moment the testing time is 1 hour, there's so much of variation. But the moment the testing time goes to 8 hours, all modalities of management are equal. So we need to create a model where a student can be dynamically assessed. So reliability of a function of sample size, the moment we have 8 hours, why not go ahead and do what is called as a real-time dynamic assessment? So we have a student, though they volunteer to get into, this could be done initially in formative assessment, because the student will volunteer to get real-time assessment evaluated. Then he chooses the topic, then subject the block, and then the system will say, give him feedback, give him whole recording. So what lectures he attended, what books he attended, he read, then museum, places, procedures. So all these resources, which has been used by the student would be monitored like a Kindle. Suppose you use the Kindle and you know what you have read. And therefore, this goes through a feedback and machine learning from past data. And this monitoring will tell, suppose we have 100 students, we have last time data that how many students have read what. And therefore, this can be upgraded with a deep learning technique. And at the end, one student decides that I finished this topic, I want to get assist. Then at a self-declared time and date, the same mechanism can be used for a question paper setting and then through a data bank, and then he goes up and then whole thing can be done. I think this would be a very dynamic new thing to happen. And I think it's very easy to possible, because at the end, if it's one data point and say multiple data points, it can give better clues. And this is now coming with what is called as a programmatic assessment. But then I think that's a topic by itself. But then this is a dashboard. Once you decide that academic governance and then student decides, then he knows about resources. He knows about what is going to happen, the governance dashboard. And then we go into details of the programmatic assessment and find out what happens. And then we want to change from, say, plan, implement, collect, analyze, share, and improve. And this cycle has to be followed in this whole process of assessment. And I think this model, I just want to all of us to think that this is not very difficult. What is required is a platform and a university like a Balaji where everything is available. And I think this has to be implemented. So competency could be assessed through this. And then we could do some of the, say, platforms like a Scrum Alliance, where this whole thing can be done because they have SEUs and then they are guide and find out, because this is a little advanced stage of how the whole SEUs can assess your performance. Lastly, I'm going to talk about resource management, because the students, while we learn, they do not know exactly what is to be done. Therefore, this is a part of a dynamic assessment, that the resource management has to be done. So therefore, so all the topics, everything from books, recorded videos, global resources, online, everything that is available could be put into website. And the student knows, the student can have a global access to the global resources. And then we can have online PowerPoint programs. And what happens is, the moment, suppose my sub-student is reading on thyrotoxicosis, he doesn't know that to see where is the patient. Therefore, we need to connect an EMR system of a medical college to a student dashboard so that he should know that where is which patient available, so that he spends less time in finding out the patient. Then similarly, suppose he wants to attend some theater. So his topic of interest, suppose let us say again thyroid, then the operation theater list can be available to him on SMS. So I think this whole thing has to be done. And then this is required an AI and a platform, that books referred by last batch, books, then this could be given a continuous feedback to the student, and they can add and then guide, and then continue, then he can go back and then he can add to the program. So this is how the dashboard will look like. And then at the end, there will be self-learning and self-feedback, like I said. And then the question paper, which is created, can be used. So I think this is all about how a dynamically, say, evaluation of a student could be done with all these technologies available and with the platforms. And lastly, just I want to talk about academic governance, because with CBME coming in big way, what is required, it is so confusing and it is so advanced, that it is a curriculum management where the ecosystem, teaching learning method, topics, and it goes to parent department where overall semester management is there. And then departments of the horizontal integration, departments of vertical integration, the teacher dashboard. So what I want is, once we have whole thing is available, this could be fit into a platform, and then everybody can see on a dashboard. The curriculum committee can see in the dashboard, the department, head of the department can see, and the whole thing can be seen. And therefore, this whole thing can go. And this is not very difficult. Yesterday only, Chinmay Shah from, say, Government Medical College, Bhavnagar, he created a learning management system for a competency-based medical education. And then if you just go, it's an app available on Windows called GMCB. And you go down and because this could be.
So in this app, learning management, competency-based learning management system, it is this initiative and this effort that ultimately resulted in this event.
I just want to sensitize because this this is available as a platform down, and therefore this can help you into governance. I'm not going to go into much detail about the student dashboard, the teacher's dashboard. This goes into whole thing about how you are planning the lectures, which methods are used, and horizontal vendor integration, and then say general physiology. Then it can be programmed to suit the teaching learning methods, then assessment method, everything can be done. And then we have the student dashboard available where he knows topics, teacher, when exactly is say lecture available, what time, then it can be suitably modified to include teaching learning methods. It can be programmed to map assigned teacher, and then we can have all the resources available which is connected. Then student, then we can have similarly a teacher's dashboard who can find out what exactly is happening, the parent department, vertical integration, horizontal integration, this whole thing can be done. I think these whole platforms are available. I think we need to use them as an advances to find out how best we can use the whole implement the competency-based medical education in proper perspective. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jamkar. I mean, it was very interesting to see that artificial intelligence can be incorporated into the question paper setting and creating a bank. I know that it is being used, and we are also using it for multiple choice questions. I just have one doubt whether can it also be applied to the short essay questions? Because
actually there is something called as a pattern recognition. I think that method has not been used. But suppose we are talking about a short question answer question paper, then the teacher has to identify maybe 10 words or 15 words out of that answer. And then computer can identify where those words have been used, and they can assess. But I think it's a little difficult story.
Thank you very much, sir. There is one question for you that has come, specifically addressing you. Already the medical education system in our country is losing basic aspect of humanism. How can this be incorporated and evaluated in medical education? That is what a question that has come to you.
Whole USMLE and all these what is called as competency-based medical education, scenario-based, where they are evaluating your, say, affective domain. They are evaluating professionalism. They are evaluating ethics. They are evaluating everything. I think we just need to work hard. It can be done through all these systems. No question.
Thank you. And see, competency-based education that is being introduced by MCI into curriculum MBBS is addressing most of these questions. One in the form of ADCOM and other things, early exposure, clinical exposure, and things like that. So the students are getting used to, and I suppose the coming next about 3-4 years, all these things will evolve. But in the postgraduate medical education, we are in the infancy, and we are trying out our competency-based education, and we have got a platform called ePortfolio, in which the student is supposed to record, and also we have the competencies written up. The assessment of humanism is being done by direct observation by the faculty. Again, it's in the infancy, and we have to go a long way. Maybe it may take another about 3-4 years to stabilize into a format. So that is what we are doing. And
at present, I am chairman of AHP. It is Academy of Health Professional Educators of India. And then we have a special group called Humanities, which is covered by Dr. Satyendra Singh. I think all these problems of humanities are being addressed. I think as you rightly said, because now the new education policy is coming. So I think whole medical education will also change. Instead of compartmentalizing, now like in US education, you can take any non-medical topics as well, where the humanities will come into picture. Because at the end, all doctors, we need to look, not look as a patient as a patient, but as an individual with human, with emotions, with problems. And therefore, all these things can be addressed, I suppose.
Yeah, that's with the introduction of the new policy, I suppose all this will be addressed. And
we need to work together to address the new education policy, because they haven't come towards medical education.
Yes, the main thing is that we have to have a lot of faculty development programs, and the faculty have to come out of this comfort zone. That is the main thing. If that happens, if that turns, everything will turn. Now, there are a few questions that have been posed to Dr. Sethuram, and I think he has answered them all in the chat box itself. So people who have put those questions can look at those answers now. And since there are no more questions on this subject, I would like to conclude this particular session by saying a few.
Are you making the recording available to all participants?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, if anybody has got any questions, they can unmute themselves and ask the questions.
Because somebody said, please send all three PPTs to the participants. So for all of you, I don't know about rest, but I will put my PPT on my website called arunzamkar.com, and it will be available to everybody. And the best part of medical education is we always share the resources, and therefore everybody is permitted to use that for further advancement of knowledge.
And there is one more question: how to use OSCE for assessing clinical reasoning and not just for clinical skills?
I think OSCEs can be modified that way. Problem is faculty development. Between all faculties, let us say, we are all teachers of yesteryears. Where the students, they know far more than us. Because MCQs, they know more how to construct than teachers, because we were never exposed to MCQs. The same thing, OSCE and OSPI, same thing. Now, what lacks is a faculty development. As a vice chancellor of MUHS, we started, say, OSCE in ophthalmology, and which was with all what you called as rigorous opposition. But then we implemented. But at the end, what happened is all faculty, while they are conducting exam, they converted OSPI into SWAT. The whole purpose was lost. That's why what is most important is faculty development. Unless you teach the teachers first, then they won't take. Do you agree, Dr. Sethuraman?
Yeah, but for clinical reasoning, I would prefer this mini-CAEX format. Because that key feature of every case is the focus of that, not actually the skill performance. So key feature, in fact, we are conducting our final year exam in December using a mini-CAEX format. So maybe sometime in January or February, I can talk about it for 10, 15 minutes, how we assess clinical reasoning using this format.
Actually, MCI is there, but I think National Board is also reasonably advanced. So last year we conducted one fellowship exam in trauma, say cancer surgery, and everything was with the mini-CAEX. And I don't think mini-CAEX has been introduced anywhere in MCI. And all the students, because there are only 16 students, everything was evaluated on mini-CAEX. So I think it also requires what you call as a decisions at the high level.
Actually, we are using the computer only, for examining the clinical reasoning. Same MCQs in a flowing format, which is, we are using that to see how they can reason out. If they do one question wrong, then the whole track changes and then they land up somewhere. So we are doing that for assessing the clinical reasoning skills.
What I want to appreciate and request everybody, that I talk about that platform which is available free for learning management system for competence-based medical education, including assessment. I think it is available free by that government medical college. Say it is by which is created by Chaitanya Shah, who is one of our dynamic member of AHP. So I want all of you to download and use, because I think platforms help you to for governance. And then creating multiple dashboards for the student, teacher, so that it becomes the life of everybody in ecosystem far more easy.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Jamka, and thank you, Dr. Sethuraman. And it's a pleasure for me to coordinate this particular webinar. And it was, I hope it was quite a fruitful one for all the participants who have been listening. And on behalf of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth, the chairman, Dr. Mr. Rajgopal, and the vice chancellor. I thank all of you for taking part in this particular webinar. And the next webinar from Balaji Vidyapeeth will be conducted on the 18th of November, 2020. And we'll announce the topic a little later, but please keep this in your diary. Thank you very much for this wonderful, fruitful session. Thank you.